Thank you very much, Christoph, and thanks to Parifoto. And before we start, I wanted to ask you all to give a very, very warm welcome to the amazing Ming Smith. I'm very delighted that we can do here a series of conversations with legendary photographers and artists, as we had planned with Christoph. I started around 1990-91 when I was a student to kind of record conversations with artists. It's always been a kind of a research project which went, you know, in tandem with my curatorial work. So very often these conversations are about producing reality. It's about, you know, working together, finding out about what projects one can do together, which is why the only recurring question in all this conversation is always the one on the unrealized project. We know a lot about architects' unrealized projects. They publish them all the time. And we all know almost nothing about, you know, artists and poets' unrealized projects, and very little also about photographers' unrealized projects. So that will be certainly a question which will be recurrent in today's conversation. Another recurrent conversation, not a recurrent question, so as to say, is always a question about the advice, you know, to a young artist or a young photographer. It's interesting in terms of transmission to a, you know, young generation. I see a lot of young artists here today, so it will be interesting to get, you know, the advice of the artists we are speaking to today. And of course, within this archive of, you know, now 4,000 hours of oral history, there are a lot of different aspects. There is an archive of course, architecture, of art, of design, of literature. There are certain themes which are covered. And, you know, every now and then a book happens. And what I realized actually, maybe when I 15, 20 years ago met Helen Levitt, is that it would be interesting one day to do a kind of a brief history of photography with all the conversations I have with photographers. We were in Helen Levitt's house in New York, in her apartment. And it was a kind of a trilogue because she had the cat on the table and there was a lamp, so the lamp gave some warmth and the cat would sit there. And so we would always sort of, you know, talk to each other and the cat would listen and somehow be really part of the interview. And Helen said, you know, several things. She said, first of all, for photographers, often books are the most important thing. So we're definitely today going to talk with all the participants about books, the importance of books. Often books are as important or even more important than exhibitions for photographers. And she also said I should kind of make it more systematic and maybe do a book on the photography, you know, interviews. And the same thing happened a few months later when I went to interview Henri Cartier-Bresson. He gave me a very unusual definition of what is a photographer. We're also going to ask that to each photographer today. He said a photographer is a hunter who is a vegetarian. I always thought it was an interesting definition. He also hated to be and really disliked to be photographed, as Joseph Kudelka confirmed to me earlier this afternoon. He never really wanted to be photographed himself. So when I started to film him, he gently took my camera and turned it around and framed the window of his apartment in Rue Rivoli. And so, you know, we have basically the film of him talking, but we don't see him. We see Rue Rivoli with many cars passing. And Cartier-Bresson, again, was encouraging, you know, to do a book. So today is also a chapter, I hope, in this forthcoming book, which I hope to do of this so far, probably about 70, 80, you know, conversations with photographers. But I wanted to really now put all focus on Ming Smith. We got to know each other when we organized Ming's retrospective at the Serpentine Galleries. I'm the artistic director of the Serpentine in London. We invited Arthur Jaffa, the artist and filmmaker, to do an exhibition. And AJ, as Arthur Jaffa is called, decided to actually use this exhibition not only to focus on himself, but to kind of use the format of a monographic show in a more generous way to actually involve some other practitioners. Frida Oropedo, who so far had only been, until then, had only been known on Instagram. So by bringing Frida's practice into the exhibition space, and you know, ever since her work is seen in galleries and museums, it completely changed her trajectory. Michelanius, who is a YouTube phenomenon and has never been shown in a museum either. So he said, you know, in the digital age, we should make these transfers from, you know, YouTube channels and Instagram, you know, into the museum. But he said at the core of it all was really for him the retrospective of Ming Smith, because he said that he was very irritated that there had never been a major retrospective of Ming's work in the big American museum, and he felt this should happen in London. And the core and the heart and soul, really, of the show was an extraordinary retrospective of Ming Smith's work. And that's how we got to know each other. It was an amazing adventure to work on this show, and we're going to talk about that later. But I wanted to begin with the first question and ask you how it all began, how you came to photography, or how photography came to you.
I never identified myself as a photographer in the beginning. I just took photographs. It was commonplace in my house growing up. My father was a photographer, artist. He painted, he sculpted, well, he called it carving, but it was sculpture. He watercolored, he drew, he, you know, taught us to draw. So when my first day of kindergarten school, I asked to borrow my mother's Brownie camera to photograph my schoolmates. So I started photographing then. But until I came to New York, I found photography as an art form.
And I think you wanted to begin with a little film, right? That we would. Can you tell us about what we're going to see?
I'd rather you just see it first and then ask me.
And then we comment it. Okay, cool. Should be a sound with the film. If we may switch on the sound, please.
Then I need to start it over.
Yeah, let's start over the film again, as Ming suggests, with the sound. If
can I start it over again?
Can we start the film again? Okay, right. Thank you. And maybe we can make the sound a little bit louder, right? Yeah. That would be good. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for bringing this film, which, I mean, there could not be a better introduction because we're going to talk about many of these works. And I wanted to come back to these beginnings because you also said when we were in London with Arthur Jaffa that when you were as a, you know, a child, that your dad would take you around the houses and would actually paint for a living, and that that somehow introduced you to the world of creativity, you know, creative sensibilities, and that your father was also a photographer. Can you tell us about these childhood memories?
So my father was a photographer, but it was my grandfather who was a painter of houses. His father came out of slavery while he was a young boy, and my great grandfather had married a Cherokee woman, a Native American. And so my grandfather was the one that was, he was a postman, which was one of the few jobs that you could work at. There were like three jobs, and the postman was one of them. But in the evenings, he would house paint. The people that I knew, the people that I grew up with, all families, they were all workers. They worked jobs. They did hard work. And so my grandfather would take me, finish a house, and then he would talk about the color of the house, the trim of the house. So I always thought that was amazing, that the aesthetic of like color and trim, that was important to him. And also in the same household, they would recite poems like Paul Laurence Dunbar's poems. So they were very cultural. They were, they didn't have a lot of money, but I always felt they were aristocrats of nature. And so I don't know if Paul Laurence Dunbar was a poet, and his poems were of that period, older than him, I think around the 1900s, like Little Brown Baby with Sparkling Eyes. You know, come to your pappy and sit on his knees. And but with this poem, that, you know, they would say like the boogeyman is going to get you if you're not good. And so, but at the end of this poem, it said about you were daddy's and mama's companion, and that you were like gold, you were like valued, you were like the joy of their life. So I thought, I think being an artist, that somehow that childhood it started, you know, with that at the heart of things. I went to see his house in Dayton, and it was the pride in the culture, the culture of black people, the culture. There was a culture going on, even though there was Jim Crow going on. And my father was a product of that, who wanted to be an artist, but his mother, who was French Creole, basically from New Orleans and lived up and down the coast of the Mississippi, she said that you would never be able to support a family being an artist, being a black artist.
Now, you actually had many different backgrounds. You studied medicine. There was also microbiology. You told me, of course, about then also your work as a fashion model and performer. And the other day I was with Carrie Mae Weems, and Carrie talked about how the training actually as a dancer was very essential for the work to develop her understanding of how to inhabit and photograph the body. So I was very curious how your experience as a model, you know, performer, somehow influenced your approach to photography, if that had an impact.
Well, I have a nickname, two names, Billy and Ming. And Billy is the more free one. It's I love all the glamour. I love dancing. I like modeling. I love fashion photography. And then there's the serious Ming. And so actually, my life has been a spiritual journey. And I wanted to study dance. I mean, I love dance, but as a young girl, I went to take a ballet class, and they wouldn't accept me because I was black. And I didn't even call them ballerinas. I called them tippy-toe girls. you're talking about like 5 years old. So one day, I was walking down the street out of Kamangi to go get some snacks for this meeting, and I heard this drumming, and it was the congo. And I ran up the steps, and it was a teacher teaching Catherine Dunham technique. And so that was like a calling. It was a calling for me because I had wanted to dance and I was going to get to it, but hearing the sound of the drum, that's what drove me to go and find out. So, and that was in the 70s. And so the more I found out about, and I was dancing, the more I found out about the technique, the more I found out about Catherine Dunham. And Catherine Dunham, she was like a entertainer. She was one had the most successful dance group, and she was an anthropologist. She was a social activist. She notated dance. She went to the diaspora and wrote, notated the movements like Isolation, which is all in hip hop today. So dance, you know, when you're spending your time like looking at lines and looking at movement, then, you know, what is a good line and a bad line? Or when you're walking on the runway, the way you move, the way you strut, your head and all of that, that you learn that. It's not like you're learning it, but because you're there and you're experiencing that, and like fine-tuning the eye, and looking to see or understanding how lighting, not even, you know, lighting and movement, how it transforms into your work.
Now also, at that time, actually in the early 70s, you became the first female member of the Kamoenge Collective, a group of black artists and photographers who were mostly active at the time in Harlem. And I'm always interested in, you know, knowing more about collectives, and I was very interested about the political aim, because it was a very political movement to actually give a political meaning to photography. Can you tell us about your, you know, memories of the Kamoenge Collective and what it meant for you to be part of that, and what were the kind of intentions of that group and the collaboration with the other members?
So it was a group of black male photographers, and they wanted to depict black people from their eyes. They, the portrayal of blacks, they wanted to have some control of that and get rid of the stereotypes. So what was the question?
Yeah, kind of the relationship also to these other members and the work you did at the time, you know, because you started to be part of that collective. So it'd be interesting to hear about your early works and also maybe about your first exhibitions.
Yes. I was inspired by Sweet Flypaper, right? Mm-hmm. Of Life, with Roy DiCarava and Langston Hughes. There was a small paperback book. He was one of the founders of Kamoenge. And so all the other work, they would meet and they would talk about their work. They would critique it and they would talk about lighting. But more importantly, I feel they were political, but they were more about the cultural value of images of ourselves. Let's see, I was going to say something.
And your first shows, you know, because there was your very first exhibition.
Well, let me see. Which one was that? There was a group
show. There's rumors that there was a show at the hairdressers. Okay.
That was my first one-woman show, which there was really no places. There, like, being a photographer was a journey, you know, that was about my conversation with my camera and the world. I was photographing for myself because there were no institutions that were, there were no talks, there were no anything, basically, for me at the time. And when I was modeling, I met a hairdresser that worked at St. Andre's. Now, you're saying, like, what does that all have to do with everything? Well, it was like a hub, a cultural hub. There were makeup artists that were working for Vogue and Bazaar. That's where I met Grace Jones. There were pioneers. There were pioneers, a lot of the models. We were all new. We were all, you know, striving. So this hairdresser knew that I was a good photographer, and he was opening a shop on Madison, which was, you know, like a place that was like high-end for him. And so he asked me if I wanted to do a show there, exhibition. And I said yes. And it was in January, it was cold. There were so many people that came. They were down the steps. But also Romar Bearden came. Roy DiCarava, let's see, just, you know, a lot of people in the community, because it was not uncommon to have, like, exhibitions at a place wherever you could get, basically, at the time.
And when Arthur Schaefer started to tell us about your work, he said that it's in the 70s, so at the time of that exhibition, that you started to photograph all these extraordinary musicians, that you started to, you know, photograph Sun Ra. It's a whole archive of you. How did that begin? And can you tell us a little bit about these encounters? Because you also have Billie Holiday, you have Sun Ra.
So I was married to a jazz musician, and I met a lot of musicians. But before that, I photographed. I actually photographed Pharoah Saunders, and music was a big part of my life, jazz music. When I was at Howard University, like you said, pre-med, although I did photograph then, my friend and my one, we would go across the campus, and this is one of the first times that I really learned of, like, John Coltrane, and we would walk across the campus, and he would sing, and my sister, who's no longer with us, we would walk down across campus, and he would say, I love Supreme. And then the other was Pharoah Saunders, but at the time I didn't even know it was two different artists, which was Pharoah's, and we would say, the master has a, the creator has a master plan, peace and happiness throughout the land. So, and then even with Kamangi, they talked about the music that they would listen to when they were printing, or music was just a part of my life. And so in traveling, you know, I photographed whoever and whatever, because I basically photographed my life. I didn't go out to photograph. It was part of my life, and almost all of my work is really about my work. Nina Simone, she said that, you know, there's a responsibility to do your work and to talk about the times. It's like your responsibilities. And actually, my work is about that. It's about what I experienced. And culture is, oh, that's another thing with the Kamangi. They were political, but they were more importantly, they were talking of the cultural value of the work. And but also, like, for example, the Black Arts Movement. You, with Kamangi, it came out of the times. It was like upheaval. There was the shooting of Martin Luther King. There was Malcolm X. There was Garvey. There were student uprisings. So And so the Black Arts Movement, which was the spiritual sister of the Black Power Movement, this came out of that. So Komangi would be like a natural growth, was born out of that climate.
And what about Roy de Caravac? I've just seen a big exhibition in New York of the work. Was Roy like an inspiration for you, or how did you relate to Roy's work?
So again, I had seen Sweet Flypaper, which was a collaboration between Roy and Langston Hughes. So when I first saw, like, I have an August Wilson series. And August Wilson, he was very, he loved Romare Bearden. There was all these artistic motivators in the community. I just want to say about the Romare Bearden. Yeah. If you went to his studio, he had a cat too. Wow. And he was like, it was like Roma and
I didn't
his
know
cat.
That. It's amazing.
Yes. And also, Lisette Modell, I met Lisette Modell in the village, who is a female photographer, and I don't have a portrait of her because she didn't want to be photographed. So it was like a lot of these artists, we have the same sensibilities of things and experiences. So, where was I?
No, but that's beautiful. I love all these connections. It's like patterns that connect. Now, you know, we talked about the jazz connection, the Black Art Movement. There's, of course, also surrealism in the work. And the kind of connection to surrealism struck me when we installed your show in London. Because, of course, in surrealism, there is this fascination for dream aesthetic. And your photography has that very strongly, because you photograph from very unexpected angles. Very often, there are blurry, out-of-focus images. There's fog, shadow, collage. Can you talk a little bit about that and about the connection to surrealism?
Well, I would have never claimed that I was a surrealist, but from where I work, I'm like the subconscious to me is like way ahead of the mind, and a lot of my work is from, you know, is like I follow my impulses, and I think in doing that, you, if it's not, if you don't stop it, if you follow that, then you automatically work from that. For example, the Romare Bearden piece that I have. So the feminine aspect of his work in this portrait is like I have him with the, you know, with feminine energies, because that, you know, we have masculine and feminine in all of us, and so somehow, you know, I don't really think about it. And that's just what someone would, you know, critique it would say. But when you work from yourself, and I think that's the main thing for artists to do, is to really work from themselves. It's not on the outside, it's on the inside, and that will automatically come out. It's like the truth within you.
So beautiful. And of course, there is this visibility, invisibility aspect, often in your images, something we discussed also with Arthur Jaffa. And I wondered if you can talk a little bit about that, about the blurriness and the sort of notion of visible and invisible.
I think Arthur is best at that. I was like, I need to pull up the video and like listen to what he has to say. But it's like timing. It's not just a blur. There is an art to it. It's like when how can I say this? Like with painters, they were like, you know, young painters are saying, oh, I could just throw, you know, some paint on the wall and that, you know, that looks. But if there's an evolvement, and so those moments in between, like my Invisible Man, it deals with like light and shadow and darkness, and all those elements together, for me, will talk about it more than, it's like those in-between moments. It's not a post moment. It's like it's freedom. It's what happens between here and there and time. So, and you're dealing with the time of meaning in that moment. It's like an energy. It's like it's there, but it's not there. Energy is like there, but you don't necessarily see it. And what we're seeing is that we're also feeling a certain amount of energy. So all of that is like part of me, of the art of photography, shooting, capturing that moment, trying to reflect really what's going on, but not like a clear image where everything is sharp, but it's in between moments. But yet, it's in that time set. It's in that setting.
Now, in terms of the visible, invisible, there is, of course, also your series called Invisible Man, and that series is based on the 1952 novel by Ralph Ellison. Can you tell us a little bit about this series and how it connects to this extraordinary novel?
Well, I think... going back to the August Wilson series. So when I was going back to Rumar Bearden was an inspiration for August Wilson and the music, and then Rumar Bearden loved Duke Ellington, and there was all these connections. And so like when I saw Roy de Caraba's book, I had an idea after seeing one of August Wilson's play, because the words spoke to me. Like, he created poetry with ordinary words of black people. And so I wanted to visually do that. And then remembering the Roy de Caraba and Langston, partnership, I went to the Hill District of Pittsburgh, and I photographed characters that I felt portrayed the feeling of his folkloric folks. There was a quote about August Wilson that he made ordinary people monumental. Well, that was what I wanted to do with my August Wilson series. Now, The Invisible Man, it's about the blackness of blackness. So if you go to Harlem, you see things, but and that has a lot of the so-called blur in it. We know it was, I have some early work that's real clear images, but I wanted to get the feeling and the, it wasn't all about this poor, because culture, I mean, when you think of black culture, what have we contributed, like jazz and hip hop? It's rich. And so just having a photograph of someone, hungry, poor, there's a richness. We're kings and queens. We have a culture that comes from the past, and so to have just this cliche or a stereotype of Harlem, I wanted to deal with that. So in a visual way, I deal with the blackness of blackness, the darkness of it, the mystery of it. So that's what that series is.
And then one thing which is also very present in the work, which struck me, when we installed your retrospective at the Serpentine, is besides the blurriness, it's also the slowness. There is often a slow speed photography, and we live in a very accelerated age, and you seem almost like to introduce slowness through this capture, of movement. So I wanted to ask you to tell us a little bit about this, because it's not so much photography as documentation, but it really sort of seems to capture, how could one say that? It seems to capture experience or feeling or sensation. So it would be great to hear you a little bit about this slowness or this slow temporality that brings in light and movement for longer.
Well, as a photographer, in the beginning, I used the camera. I would fix the aperture and the shutter speed because I used only available light. And I kind of, my style, it goes with what I had said before about the Invisible Man series. So just dealing with, I dealt really with light and the light in the darkness. And so while creating or photographing, I would see what I wanted. And many times the slow shutter speed with very little light became the focal point of the photograph. And so, I mean, I don't know, I photographed light. It's like one of my, you know, some people said, well, I painted with light to create a mood or a photograph.
And then you've also likened, in a previous conversation we had, your work to blues music. I mean, you mentioned hip-hop and jazz before, but we should also talk about blues. Quoting you, in the art of photography, I'm dealing with light. Connects to what you just said. I'm dealing with all these elements, getting that precise moment, getting the feeling, getting the way the light hits the person. To put it simply, these pieces are like the blues. Can you tell us about that connection to blues music?
Well, I think my photography and the way I work as a street photographer, it's like you go out in the street with your camera or in the world, because many times I was in Italy or Paris, and it's like improvising, like you have elements. And that, to me, for me, that was my joy, was the art of photography, was capturing that moment and you know, improvising, like, you know, a person you have to, when shooting, or someone may walk in front of you, or the light, or a cloud may change the light, or, you know, people trying to wait for the moment many times so that that person is at the right, so you know you can compose at the same time. It's improvisation. It's like nothing pre-planned, like if you set up for a shoot and you have everything in control, it's just the opposite. And jazz is that way. It's improvisation. And I also, I must say that one of the main elements is like spirituality. Like I love John Coltrane and Alice Coltrane, which they don't talk much about Alice Coltrane, but like, for example, their relationship, Alice Coltrane, she was like deep into John Coltrane's silence. So it wasn't just, you know, they played music together, but it was also in the silence of his music, the silence of his soul, the silence of, you know, being in a relationship. And, you know, giving that person the space. So with jazz, they go into a space while they're working with others. Like I'm photographing, I'm working with all the different elements, but it's also the energy or the spirit within me that comes out while creating.
Now, you mentioned Coltrane. You, of course, also photographed Nina Simone, and that's, it's my big unrealized project, is this unrealized interview with Nina Simone, because she had agreed to do it, but then it got cancelled. It was an idea of Rosemary Trockel, so it will be forever my unrealized interview, is to speak to Nina Simone. So I was very curious to hear more about your encounters with Nina Simone and how you made this photo.
Okay. So, so anyway, I first heard about Nina Simone in college, and because she was a product of that time. She was very revolutionary, and she was standing up for herself. And but she went through all the trials. I mean, for example, going back to August Wilson, he did Ma Rainey's Come and Gone. What is that? That's a play about a blues woman. Nina Simone was a blues woman. Billie Holiday was a blues woman. They were, I think, Angela Davis was talking about, they were feminists, they were women, you know, they talked about all these things and standing up and dealing with love. But also, for example, like one of the reasons, like I love August Wilson was his words, and he dealt with gender, he dealt with identity in his very first play. So the Nina Simone was someone that, you know, what is it, Mississippi Goddam, you know. But the first time I did see Nina Simone, it was at a jazz festival in Los Angeles. And I remember she was coming in, and she had, it was in the summer, and she had a fur coat on. And I was like, oh, well, she's a diva. She's going to wear her fur coat in the summertime in, you know, and I was like, that's Nina Simone. So I took this photograph. And I was just saying that she was a diva. But also, I must say that that time that she performed, Bill Cosby turned her off the stage because she wouldn't get off the stage. And 20 years later, she was the only one that had been revolved off the stage at the, I guess, Playboy Jazz Festival or something like that. But, I came back and I saw her. She was the only one that had been revolved off the stage. But when I lived maybe like 15 years later in Los Angeles, and I realized it wasn't that she was being such a diva, it's because after the sun goes down, it gets cold. So she would have her fur coat, you know. So like making an assumption about someone and then, you know, understanding that that wasn't just quite a diva. She was like me, she wanted to be warm.
And talking about the extraordinary women you mentioned, as of course, also, you know, your incredible pioneering work got actually recognized in 75 because you were the first black woman photographer to have a work acquired by MoMA, by the Museum of Modern Art. And you said in an interview that this was like getting an Academy Award and no one knowing about it. Can you tell us about this very early, you know, acquisition from MoMA? And I think I heard that they offered so little money that you initially had refused it, no?
Yeah. So I had pretty much was much a loner in photography. It was like in my house. I had just a foam and photographs everywhere. But I studied. I went to see, you know, Brassai was in New York. I went to see him. I really studied photography, and I loved the black and white, which at the time was not even, they were questioning if photography was an art form. And so it was really about, especially during that period, it was about being alone, and everything was photography, basically. It was my best friend. So they had an open call at the Museum of Modern Art, and I was living at the time in the West Village. So I brought my portfolio when I went to give it to the, as I was walking in, you know, the receptionist thought I was a like courier, and she mistaken me as a courier, and I was like, as I was walking out, I was like, I don't know why I did this, because everyone looked like they were right out of Harper's Bazaar. It was, you know, it was beautiful to me, but like I was not part of this picture at all, and I was kind of feeling, you know, down. I mean, she thought I was like a service, someone that was just dropping off portfolios. And, you know, and I had my jeans on, and so I was dressed that way. But then when I went to pick up my portfolio, the receptionist said, oh, are you Ming Smith? And I was like, yeah. And she was like, oh, well, it was a completely different attitude. She says, well, Susan Kaczmarek, John Sarkowski, the photographer, would like you to, they would like to speak with you. And so then I was like, oh, okay, like that. I was like, so they, she brought me into the room, and John Sarkowski was not there, but she said that he thought I was this and that and all these really great things. And that they, she placed 7 or 8 photographs, and she says, we can't decide, you know, which photographs and which one would you. So I chose, you know, the jazz, which was of a black jazz musician, and then the other one was a woman with the Christmas tree, Christmas constellation, because, I don't know, it's like, I wanted to give something that was totally human, and also something that was, you know, particularly jazz. So those became the permanent collection. And you told the story already. I was like, how much are you paying? This is the Museum of Modern Art. And she offered me with some amount. And I was like, oh, no, I can't do that. She says, but this is the Museum of Modern Art. People try to give us. And I was like, no, I'm not. I'm just not. And she said, you don't understand. I was like, but this doesn't even pay for my supplies, and you know. And so she said, well, let us keep these two over the weekend and come back if you change your mind, and you know, see if you'll change your mind. And I did. I went home, and I told, I was just newlywed, and he says, well, you better go get that money. And that's what I did.
Now, one thing which is important is, of course, memory. And we live, you know, in a digital age where we have more and more information. And it might actually be that maybe amnesia is somewhere at the core of the digital age. There's a lot of amnesia. And your work has to do a lot with memory. And I wanted, towards the end of this conversation, ask you a little bit about memory. Because Gordon Parks once said that your wondrous imagery, your truly wondrous imagery, gives eternal life to things that might well have been forgotten. So I wanted to ask you, tell us a little bit about memory and maybe also this drive there is, which I felt very strongly when we installed your retrospective, this drive within your practice to create an alternative archive and record the lives, the events, the histories, which otherwise might have been excluded from hegemonic archives.
Well, memory, it helps me too, because I would have forgotten so many of the events and things that happened. I mean, like looking at some of the photographs, it reminds me, the details come in, but they might have been forgotten by me as well. And the older I get, the more it happens. But so I basically feel and really wanted to contribute to the cultural aspect of black during my lifetime. And I just, like Gordon Parks, like you brought up Gordon Parks, I have a photograph of, it's called Gordon's Last Christmas, and it really was his last Christmas. And it's, and so it deals with place, because until I had lost my parents, I really didn't understand that, like, the artifacts, the place that you're in, when that person dies, that dies also. And so, like with one of my, the portrait of Gordon Parks, I have a portrait of Gordon Parks, but I also have one of his living room with the Christmas tree in it. And, you know, after he died, that was all, you know, was going to be gone. And I have that. And so, you know, that was, it's, place tells a lot about who you are and, you know, what you have and, you know, what's important to you. So, you know, it wasn't even something that I was, you know, when I took the photograph, say, of Gordon Parks, it wasn't something that, you know, was on my mind. It was just because the love of Gordon Parks, or the love of the place and who he represented it and how he lived his life. And I think that's like, you know, with everyone, we have that ability to keep those precious moments, those precious places intact with a photograph long after we're gone.
two last questions, very last question. What's your unrealized project? Do you have an unrealized project, a dream, a project, someone you haven't been able to photograph, or maybe a non-photographic project, something which was too big to be realized?
Well, I'm basically working on some installations, but I have, you know, my. So, one of the main motivators of who I am is Catherine Dunham, as I spoke of. And she went around to the diaspora, and she recorded dance. So it's an ongoing project. I've been photographing things since the 70s, including her. And so that's unfinished, and that's going, and I'm gonna do films and all kinds. It's a big, because that was one of my main reasons to live, actually. So there's that, and there's some installations. I'm also, in the beginning, photography as an art form was black and white. You weren't even considered with color. It was commercial. And so I have many work that's color that I've not printed up. So I plan to have some exhibitions on that. And also, I paint, I do oil, and that's like an ongoing process, like a painter. And I take photographs and I use them as the canvas and with oils. So I want to continue my painting. In 2000, I've done a whole series of this works that are with oils on photographs.
Very last question, as I mentioned initially, it's the Rainer Maria Rilke question. What would be your advice to a young photographer?
I think going with your passion, going with what you're interested in, working for the good in humanity. But you can't, you know, you can choose, but even more so is to like cleanse yourself, to nurture your soul, to eat right, to keep your body, to keep healthy, and spiritual practices and all of that, to keep that intact. And yes, I think so.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Vincent.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Another big round of applause for Ming Smith. Thank you very much.